Asian Pacific expression.
Community and cultural coverage.
Music and calendar.
New visions and voices.
Coming to you with an Asian Pacific Islander point of view.
It's time to get on board the Apex Express.
Welcome to Apex Express. I'm your host and producer for tonight's show, Preeti Mangla Shekhar. Today, we spotlight disability issues and rights and how, particularly during this time of the pandemic and the drastic fire ecology of California, invisibilizing the needs of disabled communities promotes ableism and lets many of our systems and ways of life privilege a very limited notion of ability. Stay tuned. We begin tonight's show with a conversation I had last week with the fierce and fantastic disability rights activist Nidhi Goyal. Nidhi is a visually disabled feminist activist from India working at the intersections of disability rights and gender justice. She is the founder and executive director of Rising Flame, a national nonprofit organization in India working for women and youth with disabilities. Nidhi has been appointed to the UN Women Executive Director's Civil Society Advisory Group and sits on the advisory board of Voice and has been globally elected to the Board of Association for Women's Rights and Development, or AWID, where she is currently the board president. In India, Nidhi has been invited to be a member of the core group on persons with disabilities and elderly persons by the National Human Rights Commission. For over a decade, Nidhi has been committed to changing the lives of persons with disabilities and has worked with a range of national and global women's rights, disability rights, and human rights organizations, including Point of View, Human Rights Watch, Sightsavers, and CREA. Her work on disability, gender, diversity, and inclusion have made their way into many corporate offices and policy spaces. Her work spans research, writing, training, campaigns, advocacy, and art. Nidhi works to raise the profile of issues at the intersections of disability and gender through op-eds, journal articles, and lectures in national and international forums. She influences organizations, systems, and structures, policies, and human rights discourses to be more inclusive in national and global spaces.
So Nidhi, welcome to Apex Express. I'd love to, you know, begin this conversation with you around the report that your organization Rising Flame created. So first, if you can begin by telling us a little bit about Rising Flame and how it came about, and then Great. We can dive into the report that came out during COVID.
Great. Thank you so much, Preeti, for having me here, and it's a pleasure to be in conversation with you. So Rising Flame literally grew out of a need of the community of persons with disabilities. It really came about and all came together through my own lived experiences of disability and my work experience in the community. So for a decade now, I have been working on disability justice and gender justice intersections. And the journey that I took as an activist, the engagements and interactions that I had with people, particularly living with disabilities, diversities from all over the country and the globe, really got me thinking what were really the gap or the areas that needed more work. And Rising Flame literally came together with pulling all these pieces of vision. And if you see the name also signifies rising is moving upwards, standing up, multiple connotations to it, and flame is sort of things that change, right? So changing the darkness, changing the stigma, changing power structures. And that's what Rising Flame does. It works, it's a feminist disability justice organization. So already that speaks of a lot of intersection there. And the minute I say feminist, people are like, oh, you're only working for women. And that's not how it works, right? We work on rights of people with disabilities with a focus on women and youth with disabilities. But really building capacities to see them as leaders of tomorrow, to build their, women and youth with disabilities to really be that platform that provides opportunities, invests in them so that they can lead and grow from the grow and lead from the front. and also just working on a range of, if I had to say themes, then leadership, voice, access, awareness, and advocacy is really where we stand. And a lot of work ranging from leadership to consent to violence to digital rights happens at Rising Flame. Speaking about the recent report, so COVID-19, 2020 pretty much has been full of COVID-19 and the crisis all over the world. You know, whenever there is a change, or even in regular, like in our everyday life, right? What we see is when there are priority conversations, people with disabilities are left behind. And just as a world who's committed to not just sustainable development goals, but as people who are committed to human rights or you know, including everyone, when in a crisis situation, folks are left behind, it gets even more difficult. We wanted to bring visibility to what's the situation of women with disabilities. Where are they standing in this crisis? So, you know, when we talk about a crisis in India, immediately, so the crisis took a very severe form from March onwards, and we went into a lockdown here. We have a Department of Empowerment of Persons with Disabilities, and they came up with a disability-specific policy. The next thing we knew in early April or somewhere around that time, we had a whole conversation of a shadow pandemic that women were facing in the form of domestic violence. And that's when we just sat back and we said, neither in our national policy nor in an international discourse are women with disabilities or the specific issues they face being highlighted. You know, later, we started thinking about who's being left out, etc. But that's how we started. We conceptualized a quick research, but an intensive and extensive research both to capture narratives and voices and experiences of women with disabilities from across the country. So you'll see we've sort of almost in a digital space situation in a country like India, where we are not still the penetration of digital ownership. Is very gendered, right? Mm-hmm. So, first of all, the penetration is not 100%, or not even like majority of people don't own digital or don't have digital access. Within that, women ownership of digital equipments is a barrier, and then disabled women is like 3 times, 4 times, I don't know how many times removed, right? But even in that scenario, partnerships, collaborations, we collaborated with Sightsavers. We then further reached out to disability networks and disabled people's organizations and really interviewed 82 women and 12 experts, so 94 respondents from across disabilities, across 19 states, to build the understanding of what this crisis has done to women with disabilities, or what have been disabled women's experiences in this crisis, and what was a way forward to ensure that we don't leave anyone behind in a humanitarian response situation. So that's why I said we really, really wanted to go pan-India and try our best to capture as diverse as voices as possible within women with disabilities as well, right? And so if you see, we almost have about 46% of our respondents from small towns and villages, equally divided, and then the balance is from urban areas. And even there, the experiences, if you read the report, there are lots and lots of testimonies of women from rural areas which have been highlighted in each section. What was important for us to now do a balancing act of sort of how to get these in-depth and intense stories and experiences on a digital platform. So through focus groups and using the fabulous technology, mm-hmm. and then through shorter phone calls, longer phone calls, group calls, etc. So multiple, but all in focus groups, all in smaller group conversations, we captured narratives and experiences. But our tool was literally Zoom and direct phones. But we also encountered where we had to send social workers to support the women, right? Because they were disabled, they'd never used technology, or they didn't have access to technology, the technology wasn't accessible, and so on and so forth. So we sent social workers. There were women who, you know, we convinced their families to give them the phone, and so they borrowed their brother's phones or things like that. So there were many barriers, and of course, disability is a very, very wide group, right? So, of course, some were not. These were rolled out as invitations to join these calls, targeted reach out, also a lot of social media invites and email invites and WhatsApp invites. So a whole range of ways that we invited participation in this, but we still should say that there were many disability groups who are not in this report, while there are many, 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 particularly those who are less given less space, even within our own movements, like deafblind individuals, deaf women, and so on and so forth. They have been a very significant part of this study, and we made extra push to ensure their inclusion and participation, putting in place all the reasonable accommodations during the interview process, and so on. So what was important for us to how do we then thematically work on, you know, showcasing these experiences or sharing these experiences, and what are the linkages even? What we ended up really doing is, you know, thinking about how this was playing out in their lives. So access, yes. Health, yes. Social protection, yes. Livelihoods or employment, education, domestic violence, emotional well-being, and, you know, following access in the beginning was, of course, food and essentials. This is how we thematically divided our report into eight parts. And if you look at this huge document that we produced in a short span of a few months, it also shows that each chapter could be a pull-out thing. So if you're an education specialist and you only want to understand how do you not leave anyone behind, or what is the experience of women and girls with disabilities in this time, you'd be able to just pull out that chapter and read as a segment in of itself. But it's been very interesting because there are so many things that we take for granted, which women across disabilities shared that was not so in their lives, right? I'm also a disabled woman, and I know this is a reality, that many things that folks could take for granted or consider it as so much a usual part of life may not really be that, or an easy access may not be that. And so within accessibility, just to think through physical, digital, and informational access. And I'd like to bring here, just for our listeners to understand, you know, deaf women, when we interviewed them, they said that when the first lockdown announcement happened in the country, there wasn't sign language that accompanied it. And I'm not very sure if that was, and I can only imagine that that is the case in many, many, many countries, because we don't follow these accessible television protocols or broadcasting protocols. So, there was no sign language. So all the only information that deaf people and deaf women in particular had, or the families or someone communicated to them urgently in that state of panic and crisis, was don't go out, you will die. And so for a few hours or a few days, they did not fully get the information about what COVID-19 was. We're talking about information that all of us took so much for granted. And we all were so confused, and we continue to remain confused about what is this pandemic, when it will end, what is the evolving dynamic situation. And when we don't create this informational access for people in different parts of the country, living with different identities in different regions, this is what really happens. You know, it's just to say that why access is important. And again, social distancing and masks have become the way of living or existing. And even for someone like me who's blind, the initial few months were extremely tough because there was no online-based services, were not on, right? In the country, the only way to grab your rations, etc., was to physically go to the store for a certain set time and get your stuff. But the infrastructure here is not accessible. And what made the world accessible for me in my country and in many parts of the world, what makes it accessible for a blind woman like me, is the human assistance. And when you cannot touch anybody and there is no human assistance on the streets, and you expect me to have an independent access to these essentials in the time of a health crisis, how does that even work, right? I could have all the caste, class, and other privileges in the world, but this would still not happen. So ranging from that to going to women in the rural areas who really struggled for food and essentials. And I'm talking about essentials even around menstrual hygiene products. So women with disabilities who could not go independently and access these products had to either ask the family members, in which, you know, there's such a taboo around menstruation in the country. And, you know, globally, it's about women's bodies and sexuality, and menstruation comes, gets wrapped around all of that. And there's not so much conversation other than our circles. We're still really trying hard to normalize it, or even whatever that means, right, in quotes. Or bring it in everyday conversations. But so for women with disabilities, the options were either to feel the guilt or shame or sense of like, oh my God, I have to ask this person to get me like a sanitary napkin, or stay and, you know, not be able to wash the piece of cloth that they were using because they have limited hand mobility or limb mobility or something like that. So it was really health and hygiene was at stake for a few months when essentials could not be accessed. And similarly around social protection, you know, why women with disabilities, and somebody asked us that these are many challenges that disabled people face. Why did you talk about women with disabilities? Because when you have some social protection schemes that don't reach women below poverty line or who are economically marginalized living with a disability at all, their family doesn't, and they've lost livelihoods, and you know, they had to shut their little kirana shops, which is like the neighborhood grocery store in the rural area. They really, really can only function their daily everything from their daily meals to their health, everything, you know, they can only function on that pension that they're hoping to receive from the government or that schemed amount, depending on the, or banking on the social protection schemes, right? In that scenario, they either are not, you know, didn't receive it, and that's what was one of our findings. But the other thing was that the husbands would take entire control and take the money away from them. And that's why it's important to highlight, you know, the gendered nature of disability as well. And if, believe me or not, you know, the access barriers, the food and essential barriers, the social protection barriers, and you look so on and so forth, the employment barriers, all of that could be linked into the violence experiences that women with disabilities had. And just to talk about that, you know, one of our respondents reported being threatened, you know, having a colleague who was threatened to that the family would withhold food and essentials that they got from outside for everyone, but they wouldn't give it to her. She was living with a disability, before she would complete all the chores that they wanted her to complete at home, because she could not independently go out and access these food and essentials, right?
Mm-hmm.
So right from there to this violence in form of, because they couldn't access. So there was a hard of hearing participant or a deaf participant who basically accessed the world through lip reading. And because there were face masks, she couldn't go and buy grocery. And so her father became abusive towards her and labeled her as a burden. We're really talking about how all of this together, the experiences are not just denial of rights. They culminate into violence experiences for women with disabilities. It doesn't remain about, it was a little discrimination, why are you making a big deal out of it, right? The sense of all that we're trying to fight, the sense of, you know, being a burden on families, having that guilt of not being able to contribute equally, of losing jobs, of being the first, because, you know, we get into a very capitalist framework. Like in the medical system, we get into a survival of the fittest framework when you have 50 severe COVID-affected patients and then one ventilator, right? I was listening to a US-American doctor in April, and they were saying that, listen, like, you know, if we have these choices, then we just look at all the markers and see who has the best chance to, like, who doesn't have illnesses, who's young, who's this, that. And people with disabilities won't make it at all, right?
Mm-hmm.
From there, for women with disabilities, we're actually talking about, you know, this whole capitalist framework in workspaces. Like, one of them working in a city in a store, in one of these retail stores, said that after the lockdown, when employees were called back, her employer lied to her and said, you know, we're not calling anyone back. And she only realized later that actually the store was open and everybody but her was invited back without any kind of compensation. Now, what this does to women with disabilities who really, really fought very hard to somehow become independent, right? That working space gives them that, not just that independence, but respect within families. It could be a gateway of not, or a way of not being abused, of having, reclaiming some power back, of really being able to even exercise some choice and agency. And when I say all of this, and when it culminates into violence, we're then looking at, you know, a range of forms of violence, from abandonment to gender stereotyping to threats to verbal abuse and so on. And this entirely links back into emotional well-being. So when the world talks about mental health, and I often say this, I've written about it, about mental health of people with disabilities, we don't generally have that conversation. You know, the funny part is that everyone is talking about mental health because they feel like they're locked down now, right? Mm-hmm. Their agency is gone, their mobility is gone. And what do we constantly, you know, my reflection would to bring to people would be, when we feel so restricted around our mobility, can we just spare a minute to think how people with disabilities, when we built inaccessible infrastructures, physical spaces, digital spaces, our conference rooms, our workshop spaces, our lecture halls, our government buildings, just our offices, when we don't create that inclusion and we restrict participation and mobility, you imagine the constant impact and harm that we are doing. Right now it's COVID-19 and you know, the management of that probably, which is causing all of this harm, if there are regions and spaces where there's mismanaged, but also just the disease in of itself is restricting our mobility, forcing us to change the way of life. But when we do the same, and it's our control, it's in our control to change the environment and make it more enabling. Many, many people with disabilities have this constant, you know, some of them turned around and said, hey, I don't feel anything because I actually have not stepped out of the house for the past 5 years because I met with an accident. Now I live with spinal cord injury. Right? So the mental health impact now that was reported on emotional well-being of women with disabilities was again very, very immense, amplifying and doubling and exacerbating the whole sort of everything, the internalized stigma, again, the dominant narrative of you're not worth it, you know, there's, you're not, we don't need to include you, it's okay to isolate you, you are anyway a burden. You cannot function like we do in a crisis situation, so you're hence you're less. All of that comes through in this report.
Wow, this report is like so overarching that, you know, we can have hours of conversation and analysis around it, because like you said, you know, we barely talk about how it's impacting poor people, and people with disabilities, like, especially if they are economically marginalized, it becomes, you know, multiply worse, right, or harder, and we never talk about it. And your report also talks about people with disabilities getting COVID and coping with that and, you know, struggling in hospitals. Could you talk a little bit about some of the anecdotal incidences that you all highlight in your report?
Yes. So we actually had respondents, none of them had COVID then. But there was a lot of fear and anxiety around if they got COVID, how would they even cope? Because we know in even usual situations in hospitals, we don't have any reasonable accommodations put in place, right? Like there is no on-call sign language interpreter. Mm-hmm. It's not a thing that happens in hospitals. Most hospitals don't have any published material in Braille. So what are you consenting to? You're generally not, you know, if they consider you an adult enough to consent and not talk to your caregiver, you still wouldn't know what you're consenting to because there's no accessible format to information. And this is a pre-COVID reality, right? So a lot of the realities that have come from the report also are pre-COVID realities, which have got exacerbated. And many are, of course, nuanced and specific to COVID. But here with people with disabilities getting COVID. Later, we saw some of the respondents circle back with us, and there was media coverage of disabled people who got COVID, and they just could not cope because, you know, it's an isolated ward. If it's not accessible, nobody orients you. How would you even function in that space? So it's really, you know, it's India and people have supported each other. So there was a newspaper report around other patients having supported them within the COVID wards to even get to the bathroom, right?
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, the other countries wouldn't be far away from this. I've been in many regional consultations at the Asia Pacific level, at South Asia level, and some discussions at the global level as well. Nobody's reported that hospitals, the systems have put in place particular access pieces to make the in-hospital COVID experience inclusive. And it is a crisis moment. So the immediate piece is that nobody has the bandwidth or the resources to do this. So,
mm-hmm.
I mean, we're circling back to what's the priority and who would say. So there are not many disabled people also saying that
mm-hmm.
we want accessibility within, because living within accessibilities has become such a daily part of life, right? Like you go to monuments and heritage sites and go on a vacation and go on to an airport and you're discriminated. The things are inaccessible.
Mm-hmm.
So inaccess and discrimination is such a part of daily life
mm-hmm.
that many a times disabled people are not... just pause and don't sort of push things. But it's really, you know, somebody was telling me that it's a crisis. How will we think of everyone?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, that's what crisis preparedness is about, right?
Exactly.
We talk about disaster management in the country. It's been termed as a natural disaster.
Mm-hmm.
And how many countries are really, really working on inclusive disaster management approaches, inclusive crisis approaches? How many countries are talking about it when crisis is not there, right? Not in the middle of a crisis, you can't start these discussions.
Right. Absolutely. I mean, so, you know, the COVID is an extraordinary scenario that has presented itself this year. And when it threw most, you know, quote-unquote, able people off, it's definitely going to disproportionately impact people with disabilities. So
that was a wonderful discussion I had with feminist activist and India's first female disabled stand-up comedian, Nidhi Goyal. Nidhi uses humor to challenge prevailing notions about disability and gender. You can follow Nidhi's work on Twitter at Says Nidhi Goyal. That says Nidhigoyal. Up next, Apex Express producer Anuj Vaidya had a conversation with Arun Cherian, founder of Rise Legs, a company that makes low-cost, high-end prosthetics in India.
On December 31st, 2017, my friend Divyanshu Ganatra invited me over to his home in Pune, India, for a small New Year's Eve celebration. That is where I met Arun Cherian for the first time. Arun is the founder of Rise Legs, a company based out of Bangalore that makes low-cost, high-end prosthetics out of cane. I'd known Divyanshu for a few years now and had watched his NGO, ABBF, Adventures Beyond Barriers Foundation, grow by leaps and bounds, making outdoors adventures from hiking to mountain biking to scuba diving accessible to the disability community in India. Diu himself is the first visually impaired solo paraglider in India. The spirit of adventure runs deep in his veins. So it is no surprise that he and Arun Cherian met and became fast friends, for they are both invested in making sure that all kinds of people with all kinds of abilities and mobilities get to experience the adrenaline rush of being physical and out in the natural world. The energetic flows of movement, the rush of air on the body on a hike up the mountain, the sensation of your stomach falling as your bicycle rushes down a slope, the weightlessness of being immersed in water, the cool dampness of waking up from camping in a mountain cave. These are the sensations that I remember you talking about as inspiring him to participate in the adventures that he undertakes, such as his expedition up to Mount Kilimanjaro in 2018, or his tandem bicycle ride through Ladakh with a seeing eye partner, making him the first blind rider to achieve such a feat. For the Vyanshu, this work is not only about facilitating the breakdown of misconceptions about disability, it is to change the story around disability altogether. I remember going on a hike organized by ABBF with a group of visually impaired students in the early years of my friendship with the Vyanshu, and that was such a transformative experience. I was a seeing partner for one of the hike participants, and it made me confront all the misconceptions that I held myself about disability. The fearlessness, the eagerness, and the joy with which my young companion bounded up the hillside was awe-inspiring as we made human chains along the edges to make sure the trails were safe. The awe that I felt was not that someone who was disabled could do something that I had not expected them to do. That was my own lack of imagination. Rather, my awe sprung from the realization that given the right conditions and care, anyone was capable of achieving goals that might be off limits to them under other circumstances. I understood then that it was not the body that was disabled, but rather it was the system that was disabled, that lacked the creativity and the care to make all things possible for everyone. By creating opportunities for people with different abilities to collaborate with one another, ABBF was creating a culture of interdependence and giving participants embodied proof that new heights could be scaled by working collaboratively. The story of Rise Legs is similarly one of creativity and collaboration, one that is driven by an inclusive vision of the world. For Arun, as for Dhyu, the possibilities emerge when we change the story, when we transform the narrative. And this is not only a matter of telling stories differently, it is also a matter of doing stories differently. This is what I call narratech, where we pay attention not only to the what of the story, but also the how of the story, for these are two aspects that cannot be separated in reality. When Arun started his career as a PhD student at UC Berkeley, he was working on a military-funded project on exoskeletons. But when the opportunity presented itself to take his work directly to the community, he seized it, and the rest is history. As he repeats numerous times in his interview, he is in the people business, not the prosthetic business. His community and clients come first, and the work is centered around meeting the specific needs of individuals. This is not a one-size-fits-all model. And much like the Vyanshu is redefining what disability means, Arun is redefining what prosthetic means. By using cane, a material traditionally associated with low-end furniture in India, to produce high-end prosthetics and art, he is bringing back livelihoods, reconnecting to traditional knowledge systems, and in the process sparking our imagination about what is possible when we think outside the box. When I visited Arun last fall in Bangalore, it was with a proposition for an artistic collaboration, for the cane that does not meet prosthetic standards gets channeled into artistic projects. Rise Art is the sister organization to Rise Legs. Over 2 days, we had numerous conversations at the intersections of disability and mobility, cane and bamboo, economics and social justice. And we begin the conversation now with Arun's response to a question about how he and cane found each other and how Rise Legs started.
As to how I did not intend to start the company at all. Mm-hmm. I was doing my PhD in the States, but I was very happy doing what I was doing, and then I came down to help my sister with her wedding. And having a background in the biomechanics of locomotion, I used to study how animals and robots walk and run. So I used to develop these wearable robotic exoskeletal suits, initially for the U.S. military, and then sort of making able-bodied people more able. We used the same suits as medical, so that people who are otherwise paralyzed and wheelchair-bound could then be able to stand up and walk using the robot. And then, you know, I came down to India to help out with the wedding, and you have this cane furniture that's beautifully bent in all these shapes, and you can sit on it. You see, if it's bent and you can sit on it, it can take weight. That's a spring. Now, it turns out that in my education, the human leg is also a spring, whether you're an elephant, giraffe, lion, human, dog, or a cockroach or a mouse. Doesn't matter how big you are or what your mass or volume is, or whether you have hundreds of legs like a centipede, 8, 6, 4, or 2 legs. All animals mathematically walk the same. That is, the leg is essentially a spring. So you can simplify to a spring. So for me, it was a curiosity-based question. That is, if the human leg is a spring and cane is a spring, can I make a leg out of cane, right? And then, so I told my professor it was a, you know, interesting idea, and then one thing led to another, and people started working with it, and then I needed more time to, you know, develop the idea, and essentially, I was, the initial set, I was giving it as experimental, and I was telling people, okay, this is just test pieces and all of that. And then people heard about it on the news and all of that, because people did marathons with it. And so then I was like, well, I'm a student, I can't make so many legs. And then somebody asked me for a bill. Right? And then I was like, yes, I shall do that. And that's when I incorporated the company, so I could create a proper invoice. Till then, it was just like a pet project. And so then, that's how I incorporated the company.
What was the research that you were doing at, like, what was your PhD on?
So,
how did that fit into this in a little more detail?
So with back in Berkeley, I used to develop I used to work for the human engineering lab and develop these rigid robotic exoskeletal suits. Then I went on to Purdue to do my PhD, wherein I was developing these soft exoskeletal suits. Instead of having a rigid robotic exoskeletal suit, we would wear a fabric. And I worked with the fashion technology department in Purdue, wherein in Professor Lisa's in her loom. So she's a professor in ancient Chinese weaving techniques.
Oh, interesting.
And so in her loom, we would weave Kevlar and aramid fibers with nickel titanium wires. And so the fabric was the robot. So every other thread in the fabric was this nickel titanium wire that if you powered, it will contract and act like external muscles. So you would wear like a jeans-like, the idea was eventually you could wear a jeans-like fabric, and that would act like a muscle amplifier. So so essentially I was studying how to optimize the shape and geometry of the weave pattern.
Got it.
Right, to make these soft exoskeletons. And because before you would have just one motor that could that was unicentric, you know, it had one axis of rotation and it could move only in one direction. But now when you have hundreds of these threads around your leg, they act like your muscles, and now you have orders of magnitude increase in your degrees of freedom. So now you can not just, you can't just bend forward or stand upright, but now you can swing, and you know, that was the intent.
So I'm seeing a thread around materials and how you can kind of use materials to support the body and to enhance the body. And so what is the relationship to cane then? How do you compare cane as a material to these other synthetic materials? And
interesting you ask that. You see, cane, you know, I had no idea what I was getting myself into. I'm a robotics engineer, mechanical engineer, computer science. I've never worked with wood before, let alone prosthetics. You know, prosthetics is when you have a device that substitutes a missing limb. I've never done that before.
Okay.
Right? And so I remember writing a mail to my professor saying that I'm going to make a leg out of bamboo, thinking that bamboo and cane are very similar. Turns out that not only are they of different species, but even the next level, they're different genus, and they're also, I believe, of different families too.
Oh, wow.
So they are, again, you can't even say they're different species, you know, they're just like way, way different. So, but they look very similar. Uh-huh. Even to date, they look very similar. But, so, cane is, unlike bamboo, most bamboo is hollow. Not all bamboo, apparently. Most bamboo is hollow. And bamboo is a grass. You know, it grows by itself. Cane, though it looks very much like bamboo, it's actually a creeper. It actually creeps on trees and all of that. And because it creeps, it doesn't have to take its own weight. Because every other grass and tree has to take its own weight. They are like conical in its shape, right? It's thick on the bottom, thin on the top. Right? It tapers. But because cane doesn't have to take its own weight, it's very, very uniform in its cross-section, making it is reasonably consistent. But then also, cane, by its fiber structure, is a natural composite, unlike carbon fiber, which is a composite, but it's engineered or an artificial composite, right? So what I attempted to do was, based on the principle that the human leg or the leg of any animal, as a matter of fact, is a spring of tuned stiffness, I try to replicate that spring stiffness. Turns out that all animals, whether, as I said, or no matter what your size, the leg stiffness to body weight ratio for all animals is essentially the same. That is, it's about 10 kilonewton per meter per kg. So I try to replicate that stiffness with cane. I still remember the first time me and the professor here at the Indian Institute of Science, we were testing it. We loaded the leg into the machine after, you know, setting it up, and my heart was in my mouth. You know, this is it. It's the moment of truth, you know.
Right.
And we were just, so the machine started, and it was like basically compressing the leg to know how much strength could take, and then it would then relieve. And it was like, you could see the graph just climbing up, 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 you know, like from 50, 60, 70, 80, 100, 150. One stick, you know, could take over 200 kgs or, you know, that's about 400 pounds, over 440, 450 pounds of load it could take. And I was like, wow, this is far better. In fact, even the professor was like very surprised that, you know, this is far better than we expect. Now, granted, there are 1,200 different species of cane, and they have different fiber structures, thereby different material properties, and essentially I shortchanged the entire process by talking to artisans and cane experts. Again, cane is not a cash crop that is harvested systematically and monetized. So there was a lot of local wisdom in the community on what is good, what is not good. And so I spoke to multiple elders to understand, okay, what cane do you suggest? Can you do this? Can you do that? And selectively reduced my testing set, and they were bang on.
Oh, wow.
Bang on.
This brings us to the other part of rise, because you have rise legs,
right,
and then you have rise art.
That's right.
Which is a new initiative.
That's right.
And what you were talking about in terms of within the cane, there still is kind of this quality hierarchy that you need, right?
Yes.
The cane that you need for medical purposes is different.
Right.
What you were talking about now, does that apply across both the prosthetics and the art, or
interesting
how
you
do you think
that
about the cane in different ways?
It's interesting you ask that, because art came from the medical work. So case in point being, we would make these art covers that were not just functional, art covers to the prosthetic legs that were not just functional, but it would also celebrate oneself. So we basically commissioned a student from an artist rather from the National Institute of Fashion Technology to basically interview multiple amputees and understand what does the prosthetic leg mean to them. What is it? Is it just a tool or is it more than that? And then how can one express? And so she came up with this whole series of art covers, what we would call the art legs. So that was our first foray into art, right? And so much so that we would make individual art pieces that were unique to the customer or the user. And that was integral to who we are because, as Rise, because we would never in just in the prosthetic leg business. I always felt we are in the people business. The goal, the leg is at the end of the day only a tool, but our end goal is to help people live a richer life, right? Get back at life and more. We don't want people to just walk, we want them to run, play and dance too, right? Of course, anybody can do whatever they want. We were like, well, now we have a lot of this cane, what do we do with it, right? And it's turning out to be, it's costing us money, and then at the end of the day, we are a company, we are not a charity, so somebody's got to pay for it. And rather than having our customers pay for it, our patients pay for it, after all the surgery and the maintenance and all that they have to do, can we create an altered revenue stream into the company so that we can now, we can now provide high quality yet affordable medical devices? And essentially, from making sets for the local theater houses to then making furniture for friends and family, we then proceeded to make high fashion art pieces because we only have a finite amount of cane. And then the goal is, can we, what is a way that we can maximize our returns, but yet create an aspirational brand, aspirational value, just so that everybody is happy. The art buyer is happy that he buys something that is unique, limited, and he's also contributing to society. We are happy that, you know, we have zero wastage of material. We are able to create high quality medical devices, yet through art subsidize the prosthetic legs. Right, and then our customers are happy that they're able to get a high quality device at a, you know, very, very affordable price. So it's a win-win-win for all three parties. And that was so we have a, we have an awesome Indian artist by the name Sanjay Kumar. He graduated from the top design school here in India, and he came up with this whole series on hyper nature, wherein he creatively interpreted nature and made these hyper natural art pieces. Like you have these pieces, you have this lamp that is 7.5 foot, 8 foot tall based on the pitcher plant. You have a rhino based chair with a brass, you know, golden brass horn that is about 9.5-10 feet tall, and it's like a throne, right? And then you have this whole golden ratio based shelf like space divider that's like, you know, that's about 12. So, you know, this whole crazy art pieces. And then the goal is we sell that at a premium. And we use that money to subsidize the prosthetic legs. And it's really the case where art will fund the innovation in the medical space so that we can do social good, which in turn provides a platform for more artists to create art.
Interesting.
So art is not just a charitable act, but it is a serious business, a strategic business unit to the company, wherein, you know, with the objectives are fourfold. One, we are promoting an artist. Two, we're creating awareness of disability. Three, we are generating revenues to subsidize the prosthetic legs. And four, we are ensuring zero waste.
Beautiful. Yeah. Can you talk about
what the challenges have been, especially in relation both to the material and how the material is perceived, and also how disability is perceived. I feel like what you're trying to do is really change the story around disability. And so what has been the perception in your experience, sort of the perception of disability and the challenges around those perceptions, and how you're kind of approaching that through your company? How are you changing that story?
You know, it's interesting you ask this question, because I don't know, or not don't know, I don't really think we are in the disability space as much as our intention is to genuinely be not just a good company, but a great company, mm-hmm. right? We have chosen a problem that happens to be in mobility, in the locomotion space. For all I care, that's also what Toyota, that is what GM and Lincoln and everybody else is also in the same space. Ours is just more personal, you know, it's a physical extension to the human body. Mm. And so again, when you design the company or even design your products, you're designing it for people. You know, it's not the tool. It's not the tool at the end of the day. I mean, of course, I'm an engineer and I'm a designer in some regards, but at the end of the day, you have to put that in its place and understand why are you doing what you're doing. It's to help people. What gets me going is helping people live a richer life, right? I just repeat what I said earlier. It's not that where they are is any less, but you know, together, you know, let's take a step further, right? Mm. That's really what it is, yeah. Right? And our goal is, how can we best do that?
Can you talk about what's coming up for Rise, like Rise Arts? What is the future? What do you hope? What is your vision for the future?
So, it's very, what we're really excited now, things are going well. We are moving to a much bigger facility, and we're looking at that facility not only to be the factory, but also the clinic, but then also an art space. Mm-hmm. So that's where it'll be, that facility where both art and medicine come together. So imagine a waiting room that will also be a gallery space. Mm-hmm. And we are also designing the space to be reconfigurable so that post-working hours or in the weekends, it becomes a cultural space so that we can, it's an enriching place for society and culture also.
A last question for you. What, in terms of investors, you said that has been a challenge, finding the right kind of people. What have the expectations been? Like, what is the vision for the company? Why has that been a challenge?
Well, it's not been an unreasonable challenge. The truth is, I've been very picky on who I take money from. Mm-hmm. So, au contraire, it's not been hard to get money. But one thing I learned having done a startup back in Silicon Valley is just as much as you need money, you need the right kind of money. Mm-hmm. So, we are not about the quickest way to the bank. Like, case in point being, the closest competitor to our product are these carbon fiber prosthetic legs that cost minimum $2,000. They go easy upward of $2,000, $3,000, $5,000, $10,000 easy. However, we are charging somewhere around $200-$300. $200-$300 for our prosthetic legs. Mm-hmm. Now, is this opportunity in distress where if somebody said, can you should really bump up the cost, you know, because there's a huge margin. We're still making good money. Mm-hmm. We're still making good money with, we have an adequate margin. And so we're not the quickest way to, our goal is not to be, you know, what's the shortest way to the bank? But we're in for the long haul. Mm-hmm. But thankfully, there are people I'm happy to partner with and who will help us grow leaps and bounds. And I mean, that's my learning. That's my learning. So it hasn't been challenging as much as I just had to be judicious and make hard decisions just so that we could keep the vision intact in some form or another. Not to say that what I'm thinking is right and perfect and all, but...
The question of mobility and disability is something that we need to consider carefully and thoughtfully in this moment, especially as climate chaos and the pandemic reveal the stark social inequities in our society, leaving disabled communities extremely vulnerable and at risk in the face of these onslaughts. In California, disabled and elderly folks have been disproportionately affected by our new fire ecology. What lessons does RiseLeg have for us in this moment? For one, it is that our models of research, learning, and of business need to be people and community-oriented, as opposed to being profit-oriented. But for me, the biggest lessons come from the cane itself, a material that is ubiquitous in India, but also so undervalued. Arun's work reminds us not to take anything for granted, to move beyond assumptions, and to reconsider all the tools and materials that we have at our disposal to find creative and sustainable solutions to our problems. The reason for cane's strength is that as a creeper, it has the support of other plants, which allows it to develop a certain strength and resilience. In using the cane to build prosthetics, Arun is making that strength and resilience available to those who need it, enacting the principle of reciprocity and interdependence that we need in order to survive. Special thanks to Divyanshu Ganatra and Arun Cherian for the work that they do and for sharing their time and knowledge so generously. To learn more about ABBF, please visit abbf.in. And to learn more about RiseLegs, please visit riselegs.com. That's RiseLegs.com. Until we meet again, stay safe, everybody.
That is Anuj Vaidya in discussion with Arun Cherian, founder of RiseLegs, a company that makes low-cost, high-end prosthetics in India. And that brings us to an end to tonight's show. Apex Express is produced by Miko Lee, Ayame Angelina Kian Lee, Tracy Nguyen, Anuj Vaidya, and me, your host and producer tonight, Preeti Mangla Shekhar. A big thank you to Freewilling Frank for his technical support. Our theme music is by Asian Crisis. For feedback and show suggestions, please email us at apex@kpfa.org. Tune back in next week at 7 p.m. for another edition of Apex Express.
Community announcement for November 2020. Are you behind on your rent? Are you worried about your housing situation or about being evicted during this coronavirus? Alameda County has passed strong protections to stop most evictions throughout the entire county. Oakland tenants may even qualify for added protections. Please consult an attorney for details on how this protects you. Centro Legal is available to help. For free legal assistance with housing issues or for more information on how this moratorium protects you, call 510-437-1554 and or visit centrolegal.org. This community announcement is produced by the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Please send your listing to calendar@kpfa.org. You can hear this listing again at 848-6767 extension 621 or view it online at kpfa.org.
Wake up Friday mornings on KPFA with Rising Up with Sonali at 5 a.m. Then at 6 a.m., it's the first hour of Democracy Now! With Amy Goodman. At 7 a.m., Upfront delivers a mix of local, state, and international coverage through challenging interviews, civil debates, breaking updates, and more, hosted by Janine Etter. Then, at 8 a.m., it's a weekly update on climate change and its effects on a local, national, and international level on A Rude Awakening, hosted by Sabrina Jacobs. At 9 a.m., it's the second hour of Democracy Now!, followed at 10 a.m. with Economic Update with radical economist Richard Wolf. Then we take a look at political and social issues in the Bay Area and beyond on El Show with Andre Soto. That's Friday mornings on 94.1 KPFA and kpfa.org.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K24 8BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at KPFA.